later will catch on with us as we progress. So welcome everyone to this Zoom session organized by MoCA. And as you all know, MoCA stands for the Museum of Christian Art. And yes, we have been closed for the last almost 3 years now. And like I said, we're very keen to open. But in the meanwhile, while we are trying to, you know, get our things organized for the reopening, we have started our sessions on Zoom just to keep everybody interested in Goa's heritage. And Christian art is one important and integral part of Goa's artistic heritage. And thank you, Heta, for joining us for this session, for accepting our invitation to you know, join in this session while we walk through some of the interesting objects that we will be talking about, the artworks that we'll be talking about, and sharing insights. You know, two of us who have been associated at me at the Museum of Christian Art, and you as part of Goa Heritage Action Group, and also, you know, having that wealth of knowledge related to heritage. I knew you before I joined the museum, in fact, through your book first, and of course then meeting you in person. And the book is literally always with me in the back. I'm sure it's here in and around old Goa. I constantly refer to it. So yes, you know, you actually give such a lovely all-round perspective of old Goa, of how it is and how it was. So I think let's make that our starting point and take it from there. I always like to use the Convent of Santa Monica as my base because I've been here. It is my base and it becomes my base for a lot of what I talk about. I'm very passionate about old Goa, about the Holy Hill. And I'm sure all of you know that we do a lot of heritage walks. We have been doing in the past, and now we encourage all other groups who are also working on heritage walks in this area, and we collaborate with them to just bring about awareness of the wealth in terms of art and architecture on the Holy Hill in Old Goa. So without further ado, let me start.
Thank you, Natasha, for having me. It's a pleasure. I don't claim to be an expert on Christian art, but my interest is because art and architecture from Old Goa and from the old churches has walked and traveled to the village churches and chapels, and then to the private houses. And as you know, my main interest is on heritage houses.
Yes.
But I see the connection all the time, the architecture and the art.
Yeah, so talking about the architecture of this convent, it's something that is iconic in Goa. You know, the flying buttresses at the Convent of Santa Monica, which actually were a later addition to the original structure. It came about much later to the original foundation of the building. So here is the foundation plaque of the building. It's a commemorative plaque with the coat of arms of the founder, who is Aleixo de Menezes. And it dates to the 6th of September, 1606. So that was when the foundation stone was laid, and prior to that they started the construction. And as you all must be aware, it took about roughly 20 years for them to finish with the construction of the convent, which was Asia's first convent for nuns who joined. And it was a cloistered convent. So besides taking the regular vows of poverty, chastity, and obedience, they also took vows of isolation and never stepping out of the convent once they joined this convent. So it's really interesting, you know, the life of the nuns who lived here. And maybe that's a session for another day. But today we'll focus on the artworks that we have found in this convent that many are not able to see, because though it's no longer a cloistered convent, it continues an institute for nuns who come from all over India, and they come here to study their courses in formators courses and courses in philosophy and theology. So it's more like a private institution and public don't have access. So a lot of the artworks are not accessible by the public at this moment. So through this presentation also, we'll give you a glimpse into some of the artworks in the convent of Santa Monica. So Heta,
but before you
take, before you decide,
I'm in my mind's eye going back to the 17th century and all these cloistered nuns who had inhabited this beautiful building.
Mm-hmm.
There were absolutely no men around, Natasha. You must remember that.
Yes.
The nuns were doing everything from gardening to farming to drawing water from the well,
mm-hmm.
to making vegetable and mineral dyes, bleaches,
and
for the artwork.
Yeah, for the artwork.
For the artwork. Because yes. where did the paints come from? They made their own. Some of these nuns must have been botanists.
Mm-hmm.
Definitely.
Yes, and we see that also, in the artworks as well, yeah. as we go through.
And you must also remember and share with our friends that these nuns not just came with their material wealth, they came with lands that they owned, they came with their jewelry, their gold, and they also came with slaves. And these slaves were from Japan, China, Malacca, Sri Lanka, other parts of India. So it was really a cultural amalgamation of so many different women. The food, the gardens, the artwork, everything you see here is an assimilation of those cultures.
It's very true, Heta. I mean, you know, once you start looking at the artworks and reading about the life of the nuns, you get to know of this amalgamation of cultures. I take you now into the Chapel of the Holy Trinity. It's spectacular. It's a small chapel in the convent and it is like our little own secret Sistine Chapel in Old Goa here, where you can see a ceiling that has been painted with murals and on the walls as well. I'll give you a closer glimpse of what the ceiling looks like. So here we have, various scenes connected to the birth of Christ and around that time. So we have the apparition of the angel to Saint Joseph, here to the Virgin Mary. You have the birth of Christ. I'll take you to the next slide so that you can see clearly the apparition. And along with these scenes, you'll see a lot of detailing work around, you know, which are floral and vegetal motifs all around it. So, which again is very local. So this is the scene of the nativity, but here the baby Jesus is surrounded by this choir of angels.
I don't know what you make of the costume of that the angels are wearing, because it looks very Eastern to me.
Mm-hmm.
It's like a long skirt with a long tunic. And a collar. So it looks extremely Asian to me, the dress.
And
you see the same thing in St. Francis of Assisi also.
The angels there also wear similar
long skirts with long tunics. True. and a waistband. The flowers are also very Indian.
Yeah. So here this scene is of the meeting of the cousins. No? So you have the infant Jesus meeting with his cousin Saint John the Baptist and his mother Elizabeth. So a beautiful depiction here of them meeting as children.
I believe Saint John jumped in his mother's womb. When she visited the Virgin Mary.
Yes. And that's why they have this reenactment.
The São João festival.
The São João, yes.
Yeah.
So this again it's actually a scene which is not from the main panel, which I just showed you, but on the side of the on the wall, which is actually the Virgin Mary with her mother, Saint Anne.
Saint Anne.
Yeah, Saint Joachim, Saint Anne, and the Virgin Mary. Again, a rare image. You usually you have depictions of Saint Joseph with child Jesus, but here you have an adult Jesus seen along with his mother at the deathbed of his father, Saint Joseph, his foster father, Saint Joseph. This is on a wall. Heta, you've seen it with me. This is on a wall, and the part which is of Saint Joseph, it's actually a wooden
cupboard.
Yeah, it is a cupboard. So the painting just transfers onto that cupboard to complete the whole scene of Joseph and Christ and the Virgin. Okay.
This is my favorite.
This is your favorite. So I'll let you introspect on this one and, share with us.
First of all, of course, everybody will guess this is the Holy Trinity. And very rarely do you see the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit in human figures. I think very rarely. The Holy Spirit is always either a dove or a lamb or a lamp or a light. But here you see...
The Holy Spirit is usually represented as a dove.
Dove.
And you very rarely see it in this human...
Human figures.
Yes.
And the other thing is the halos, Natasha.
Mm-hmm.
We've always seen halos as ovals or,
circular.
Yes. But here we see them like squares.
Yes.
Almost like graduation caps.
Also, if you look, I mean, the only way you can differentiate between the three identical men as...
Okay. Yeah.
Called is only because of the circular discs in the chest, around the chest of these three images. The physical features are identical, with the exception that in the center, the God the Son is having a lamb, so symbolizing the Good Shepherd. But it does not look so much like a lamb. It looks half. Its features look more like a monkey.
Monkey.
Yes. So, the Professor Vitor Serrão, he's from the University in Lisbon, and he has said that, while the main paintings in this chapel may have been done, the entire paintings must have been done in two phases. The first is where we saw the panels of the nativity scenes and the apparition. And then the second phase must have been the ones on the walls. You know, much must have happened a little later on. So they kept adding on the paintings as and when, I presume, they had time. There are also references that there were local artists' workshops that were taken on for these decorative to decorate the churches and convents of old Goa. I don't know how much of the decoration and painting inside Santa Monica was done by these artisans from the workshops in Old Goa. So here there is this painting on the wall in the same chapel, which is with birds. Now, I have been to this chapel several times and I've never before seen it. So it's something that you just miss if you're not looking very carefully. And suddenly I see all these birds when I start zooming into my camera. And it reminded me of what Heta had written of about the Convent of Santa Monica when she had researched for it. And Heta, you referred to, the in charge of the convent who was the prince, who was called the peacock. And you had an in charge, the doorkeeper, who was another bird, I think the sparrow. So suddenly, it all connected. And then you see all these birds, parts of nature coming alive in this chapel of the Trinity. So much.
Yes, Natasha, they were supposed to relinquish the world.
True.
So you leave the world out completely. In that sense, you leave your name also. So mm-hmm. they were given these bird names.
Mm-hmm.
And therefore, that identity
birds.
Completely our birds. Yeah.
So we take you now into the basement of this convent, which is the refectory for the nuns. And to this day, it continues to be partially a classroom, partially the refectory for the nuns when they are studying there. And this is an entire ceiling that is painted with martyr saints. We look closely here. These are all saints who were martyr saints. We know because of the sometimes an arrow which is piercing their chest, sometimes a palm frond which they are holding, which is an iconographic representation to show that they are martyr saints. So quite a few on that ceiling there.
Also, the floral borders.
Floral borders all over.
All over. Beautifully done. Beautifully. What jumps up in the whole of the convent is the profuse use of color.
Color.
Now, if you compare it with, say, cathedral, or you compare it with Bom Jesu, there's a lot of woodwork and gold over there.
Correct.
But here, what you see is less gold, less wood, and direct painting on the walls, full use of color.
I think the abundance of the vegetables that was available, which made themselves, I'm sure. But it must have been a lot of work at that time, and I know for sure it's a lot of work now, because it's not easy to keep this in good conservation because of high levels of humidity, especially in the basement of the convent. But even the other paintings in the Chapel of the Trinity, it is really challenging to keep it in good conservation state. So that's something else that, I feel today's talk should also revolve around, the challenges of keeping these in good conservation. It's not really easy. And because of that, at one point it is said that the entire convent must have had murals like this. Mm. Very little of it is left, because either it has got lost over a period of time due to humidity, or it was just painted over with lime wash, or then at a later stage maybe cement, because it was something that was fading. And as time went by, people may have not really understood what was really there in the paintings. But now I've seen it over the last several years. It's in a relatively good condition, but it needs the conservation, if there is a possibility of conservation.
One reason why they painted directly on the walls was because in our kind of climate, they couldn't have velvety curtains and tapestry and all that. Mm-hmm. So they decorated the walls instead.
Yes.
So it's for two reasons, the humidity destroyed the curtains and fabric, and therefore they painted on the walls.
On the walls.
And now centuries of humidity are destroying that.
True. So this is an overview of the church at the Convent of Santa Monica, and it's the church that has been restored recently. So this church is a state protected monument, and the Museum of Christian Art, along with architect Ketak, put together a proposal for the restoration of this church, got funding for it from the state archaeology, and along with Ketak Nashnolkar, of course, who most of you know, and with Giuseppe Stana and Miguel Mateos, two conservators from Portugal, art conservators, and with the Bico family. They are the team in Goa that does a lot of church art restoration. They worked together towards the restoration of this church. Again, I'll say it's challenging. It's always challenging to keep it in a good condition all the time, because we have 4 or 5 months now, 5 months of incessant monsoon, and it is always a challenge to keep this in good conservation. We try our level best. So this is an example of an arch that, when we started the conservation, was completely, there was very little of it. Nothing could be seen because it was hidden under lime wash. But when they opened up little windows to research, they found some floral elements, and then they kept working on it, and they managed to restore this arch. But I will not dwell too much into this today because we have Giuseppe Stana, who is the conservator who has worked on, one of the conservators who worked on this project, who will be speaking with us a couple of weeks from now on the conservation efforts at the Church of Santa Monica. And that is really something that y'all should all join in for, because it's really...
It's a coup, Natasha's yeah. coup.
Okay. This again, this is a pulpit in stone and has this beautiful floral motif mural all around it. But for 300 years, nobody knew of this because over this was a wooden pulpit, which was taken down at the time of restoration because it was damaged and it needed to be restored. We've not put it back together. We hope to at some point assemble it and keep it by the side so that one gets to see both. But what we discovered was the original stone pulpit of the 17th century. So today, if you visit the Church of Santa Monica, what you will see is the stone pulpit with the mural. But more on the condition of how they found it and how they went about with the conservation on this one is for Giuseppe Stana's talk a couple of weeks from now. This is a painting of, on a wooden panel of Our Lady and Child Jesus. Very interesting because the other conservator, who's Miguel Mateos, who passed away a few years back, and he could not see the conservation work to its completion. But in this, he did conserve two painting panels and did a lot of work on the image of the Weeping Cross. So this is one of the paintings that he conserved. And while he was taking off the layers of dirt and dust and taking off the layers of varnish, he suddenly discovers, can you all see the cursor yes. around this, yes. this yes. part? And you can see a face, a human face here. Now, how did that appear there? That's something that all of us kept wondering. So it could be that it was an older, it was painted over, or it was part of a larger panel that was destroyed and what was saved was only this. So there are many hypotheses, we really don't know, but we thought it would be interesting to leave that face there to show the visitor that, you know, this must have been something else at one point in time. Today it is the beautiful painting of the Virgin and Child. This again is to show you the painting of the Dormition of the Virgin. Sorry, I'm really sorry. How we went back. Okay, here it is. The Dormition of the Virgin, and she's being carried by the apostles, and her ascension alongside Jesus. It's a very unique depiction, a very unique painting. And again, here Miguel Mateos. This is the condition in which the painting was when the conservation work was taken up, and how he managed to conserve it beautifully. So this is the condition it is in today. And they also found out through research that the painter was commissioned by the priest, the Augustinian priest who used to celebrate masses at the Church of Santa Monica, who's Diego de Santana. And he commissioned a workshop in Old Goa, and the master painter in this case was Alessio Gudino, who was a local. So in this case, we know specifically who the artist was, but in most of the cases, we don't know. It could be that it was Alessio Gudino and his team, but it could be anyone else, especially in the later years. This is still the middle of the 17th century, and so we know that in this case, it is Alessio Gudino. These are the beautiful blue tiles that you'll see in the Church of Santa Monica. In this image here, you will see only the grapes, but there are grapes and pomegranate. Again, you know, symbols related to Christianity. But these are from the 17th century. I don't know for sure whether tiles from Portugal, the azulejos from Portugal, were being brought down to Goa at that time, because a reference to this particular tile in the National Museum of Tiles in Lisbon states that it was manufactured or produced in Bijapur. Mm. So I really would like if somebody do some more research on, you know, or throw more light, or somebody's already done research and to throw more light on these tiles and whether they really came from Bijapur or were they manufactured in Portugal and brought down here. It's something that we would like to analyze a little more in the 21st century.
But to me, Natasha, they look like Indian renderings. Mm-hmm. Because, you know,
in terms of the floral elements.
Floral, yeah, elements. And also the kind of grapes, you know, the kind of rendering there is. Mm-hmm. It could have been done by an artist who's never seen a vineyard. Mm-hmm. Really, actually, never
seen. To do it. Hmm.
Possible.
Also, the colors are of the 17th century because the blues of that time are very different from the blue tones that we get today.
Also, there's a variation in the production. Mm-hmm. It can't have been a very high end or a very, very, very good quality production.
Yes.
So you see that some tiles are almost faded.
Yes, they have. Also, Heta, you know, this is one example that we see in the church, but we have also discovered inside the convent that there were tiles that were put on the walls, on the floor. External tiles that have been put, some of them have been destroyed beyond repair, but we have found during our works here in the convent some tiles which I have salvaged and hopefully will be able to show them at some time, you know, if we have a temporary exhibition, and to show these hexagonal tiles that we have discovered over the last few years in the convent of Santa Monica.
Very interesting.
So now we come to another artistic element in the convent, but not seen only in the convent. This artistic element is seen across many of our churches in Old Goa and in Goa, but also Heta has done a lot of research, and you know, you can share with us a little more about Scravito.
This is Kavi art, which I believe originates in Goa. And is seen in temples and churches and chapels and sacred spaces in homes.
Okay.
So if you are in a Hindu home and you want to demarcate a temple area or a sacred area, you would demarcate it not with a screen or a wall or some or a partition, wooden partition, but you would demarcate that area with this Kavi art. Mm-hmm. And Kavi art is basically soil art. So red soil, charcoal and lime mixed together on a whitewashed wall, the etching is done, the design is rendered, and on the etched out part, the kav or kavi is filled in.
It's filled
that
in.
Is basically. It can also be done in reverse, where it's more red, less white, and the white is filled in. Mm-hmm. So both ways.
Both are techniques that have been used.
Both are techniques that have been used, and they've been duplicated also. We mm-hmm. have some scholars who are now studying Kavi and are trying to replicate Kavi in different climatic conditions.
Conditions.
Yeah.
They have lasted really well in our churches. In some cases, we found them intact when we were carrying out the works in the church. In many cases, they were hidden under lime wash. Like in this case, half of it was lost completely, but half of it we managed to, so this part we managed to find under lime wash, but the rest was lost. And here we did not do the Kavi technique, but we used a stencil, yes, because of less time. And also the technique was not something that was well practiced. So it was felt, we'll just give this, complete this panel with a stencil instead.
Now, even in temples in Goa, for example, Sri Morjai in Morji, mm-hmm. you will see that all the Kavi, there's only one border that remains that is the original. The rest is all overpainted.
Overpainted.
But instead of mourning and lamenting about it, I always feel that at least the motifs have been saved.
Yes, and we have to see that at least that remains for future.
For future.
So taking off from the sgraffito that we find in the church, I'm moving to the Church of Our Lady of Rosary, just further up the hill from where the Convent of Santa Monica is located. And again, here we find a lot of sgraffito on the walls of this church. The design, Heta, is they vary slightly from what, not slightly, I think quite
a bit
different from the ones that we find in the temples. The floral ones are maybe the only common ones, but I think in the temples they are more figurative as compared to the ones in the churches.
Temple Kavi very quickly is divided into three different groups. One is borders, mm-hmm. the other is figurative art, and the third is medallions or mudras.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, you had mandalas and so on. So these were the three, basically the three groupings. But in Christian Kavi or sgraffito, you don't have the grouping at all.
Okay.
There's practically no figurative art except for that one lion with the
crown. The lion that we saw in the previous.
But otherwise, it's only decorative.
Yeah, yes. Only decorative. I think this is the only example that we see of a figurative, case an animal motif, the lion with the crown that we see mm-hmm. instead of.
And prominent claws.
And prominent claws, yes. So this is in the sacristy of the Church of Santa Monica. It's not in the main church.
Maybe because it was sponsored by the crown.
By the crown, yes. It was this convent received royal patronage. So yes, it could be one of the reasons why the lion appears there.
Mm-hmm.
This is again the sgraffito that is in the old Archiepiscopal Palace in Old Goa. That is the building that is between the State Cathedral and St. Francis of Assisi.
Yeah.
In the chapel dedicated to Our Lady. Yeah. I think this again here, I'm not sure whether it is a stencil that has been done instead of the actual sgraffito that might have been.
Some of it, I remember Vikas Dilawari did the conservation of this building.
Okay.
And at least up to a point.
Mm-hmm.
And whatever they could salvage, they've kept the way it was. And what they couldn't salvage, they replaced with renderings in stencil.
In stencil.
Yeah, as far as I know.
Okay. This is the chapel at the Mount, Capella de Mont. And here again, the same team that did the conservation of the artworks in Santa Monica had earlier done the art restoration in the Capella du Mont. And again, there was a lot of sgraffito and murals in this church as well that was restored by them. Now we come to the cathedral in Old Goa, and what many of us must have missed, you know, you are so overwhelmed with the altar when you get into the church that and there are so many chapels and the detailed sculptures to see that we miss out on something that's as interesting as Adam and Eve on one of the arches in the church.
Very coy Eve and Adam saying no, I don't want.
So this Adam and Eve came across 3 years back when I was researching for another paper that I was doing with Monica Reyes and Heta for Intact. But I'm sure Heta must have known about this much before, or did you also come across this?
No. I had seen it, and I saw it was like my secret.
Secret.
My secret, because I didn't know enough about it. But I just felt that they were very childlike in the rendering, and I don't know whether those are berries or apples or what they are. I don't know, but they're all over this ceiling and the wall.
Mm-hmm.
And the drawings could have been done by a very young priest or somebody who's very childlike, I thought. If we move further, you'll see the kind of drawings there are. They're very, very simple renderings. And the animals
This is where it actually is. Here are Adam and Eve. And the Garden of Eden. All on this arch.
Yeah, and there's a mongoose. There's a large Malabar giant squirrel somewhere. There's a dove. and all the animals and birds are totally disproportionate.
Yeah, so this is for all our friends who have joined today's session. Spend some time, find this place in the cathedral, and, you know, spend some time just observing this, because there's so much to see in this Garden of Eden along with Adam and Eve. As Heta mentioned, there are so many animals to be spotted.
This is, I'll give you a clue. It's just opposite St. Peter's niche.
You're being very kind, Heta. Okay, this is something again that all of us have seen in the cathedral. It's just next to the main door of the cathedral, and it is of course Saint Christopher carrying Jesus on his shoulders. I remember reading this lesson in my Portuguese textbook, this legend of Saint Christopher and Child Jesus. And I used to just try to picture it all, of this Saint Christopher carrying him across the river and then
Jordan.
Yeah, and then I see this painting and it all comes to life in this. But Heta, you can maybe share with us a little more about.
Yeah, but what I feel is it's obviously been done by an Indian artist, mm-hmm. a Goan artist, and he has rendered Saint Christopher in Indian dress, mm-hmm. with a dhoti. He's a working Saint Christopher. He's got his dhoti right up above the thighs, stocky, sturdy body features. And also the vest that Saint Christopher is wearing is tied with the ties and no buttons.
No buttons, yes.
So that's the Indian garment for sure. And reminds me a lot about Vasudev carrying baby Krishna.
Mm-hmm.
Somehow, you know, there's a parallel story of how Vasudev carries baby Krishna across the river.
Okay.
So that the other thing is, there's a European kind of monumental kind of castle kind of structure in the background. Mm-hmm. But this is very, very common. You see it in a lot of glass paintings done by Goan craftsmen also.
Okay.
They would have a European monument at the back as a backdrop, like a German castle or something. And then an Indian figures or a peacock or a Saraswati goddess flying over the castle on a hansa.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So this is, to me, it's very clearly a contribution by a Goan craftsman.
Goan artist, yes.
Artist, yeah.
Move on. So, this is an oratorio that Fraser has shared this image with us. Fraser's here with us for this session. And if any of you don't know Fraser, he's a very young, enthusiastic heritage lover and loves everything that is heritage. And he collects a lot of art objects, especially Christian art objects, in an attempt to safeguard them, you know, from getting destroyed, damaged. And this is an example that he shared with me of an oratorio. And like Fraser, there are so many of us, you know, who are custodians of Christian art. We have another example here of an infant Jesus in a cradle that is from the collection of Daniel D'Souza. I'm not sure if Daniel is here at this moment on this for this session with us, but this is from Daniel's collection, the infant Jesus, which many of us use in our Christmas nativity cribs here in Goa. And, you know, sometimes they're not always in this cradle. They're just without a cradle. I guess it depends on, it depended in the past on how much the person who commissioned the work had, you know, how much money they had to spend, whether they could afford a cradle or they just were satisfied with the ivory infant Jesus. But I was also given to understand that this infant Jesus was given by a mother to her daughter as part of her trousseau, in the hope that she would conceive
a baby boy.
A baby boy, yes. And of course, now we don't have ivory, but some other material might be used, and, you know, and this gift given from mother to daughter may still be continuing. I'm not sure. I was given one, but I'm not sure about the tradition still continuing. But nevertheless, this is an interesting representation of the infant, and the embroidery on the little bed is silver thread. As Heta has seen this firsthand, she was able to tell me that it is embroidery in silver thread, like zari work on the fabric.
Yeah, on velvet.
On velvet, yes. Yeah. And this is an example of the infant Jesus from the collection of the Museum of Christian Art. And I must share with you that, you know, every visitor that we get, most of the times the Indian visitors who have come to the museum in the past, when they look at this, they say, what is this baby Krishna in this Museum of Christian Art? And then I have to say, but this is baby Jesus, you know, he's in a cradle. And they just, the comparison they try to make, the similarities they try to draw are simply amazing. So they've really rechristened this as Bal Krishna.
Well, one of the things to look at and interesting things is the anklets.
Mm-hmm.
Anklets, bracelets, waistband.
Waistband, yes.
Necklace. Some of the baby Jesuses had earrings also.
Mm-hmm.
And also, when you see baby Krishna, he often has his big toe in his mouth.
Okay.
Infant Jesus has a finger.
Yeah, sucking on his thumb. Yes.
Yeah, thumb.
I'll move on. To another, I'm focusing a little on the collection from the Museum of Christian Art because the museum has been closed for a long time. And this is a processional banner like many that we see in our churches in Goa. But something that I would like to highlight here, which is unique to our processional banners and many of our textiles in our church, used in our churches, and that is besides the intricate embroidery, the zari embroidery, you will see here the face and the hands of this Saint Joseph and baby Jesus are in ivory. And they are sewed on to the textile. This is something that's very unique to Goa. Until somebody else tells me that they've seen it and found it somewhere else, I will keep claiming that it is very unique to Goa. And sometimes we have not been aware, and sometimes because textiles tend to deteriorate fast, not many might have survived from the past in our churches. And also because the ivory sewed onto the textile, sometimes the ivory must have got dislodged, you know, the thread must have snapped, and sometimes the ivory just gets lost, and then they replace it with some other material. On the instead of the ivory hand or face, they would replace it or just let it remain without a hand or a foot in this case. But this is an example which we have all the ivory intact from the museum collection. Again, an embroidery. There was a question here from Fraser on what do grapes, pomegranates, and pineapples mean in Catholicism. There's a lot of symbology with the fruits. Fraser, for grapes, you know that it represents the blood of Christ. Pomegranate, it symbolizes, it symbolizes the Christian community. But again, it comes from the Jewish tradition also. And it also has a similar meaning in Islam as well. So, you know, the fruits, it overlaps across religions. In the case of the pineapple, I'm not very sure, but I know that it was a tropical fruit that must have come to these regions to Goa from some other region and then grew in abundance here and must have inspired, but it would have a Catholic meaning, a Christian meaning as well in this particular case, because this was on a chasuble. This is a chasuble that would be used by a priest.
Natasha, the pomegranate also means a lot for Zoroastrians.
Okay.
It symbolizes good thought, good word, and good deed. So for all our prayers, pomegranate is one of the offerings that's absolutely essential.
Okay. That's a very interesting tidbit of information for us, you know, so that we can share. Because like I said, in the church, we do have the pomegranate alongside the grapes in the tiles. So we can now compare it even to another religion. Again, showing you another representation of the Holy Trinity, where we have God the Father, God the Son and the Holy Spirit in the form of a bird here. Now this
doesn't look very much like a dove.
No, it doesn't look like a dove. It looks more like a phoenix or an eagle, but not like a dove, but it is meant to be that. And it is being done in this Pietà style, the Holy Spirit. Instead of the Virgin Mary, you have God the Father on whose lap Christ is now sitting. And around you see these angels on clouds, and they are holding the symbols of the Passion of Christ. So you have the cross, the nails, and the pillow on which he was scorched. There's a very interesting story to this Holy Trinity that we have. So most of you must be knowing Mr. Percival Noronha, who passed away a year back. And so he was part of the museum committee. So he told me firsthand the story of how he found this object that was lying in a bush near the St. Augustine's ruins around 50 years back. And how he found it, he cleaned it, and he offered it to the cathedral, the Say Cathedral. And it was kept there for many years. And when the museum was being set up, he requested that it be given to the museum for display. And that's how it has reached the museum. But just to go and say, you know, how much of this must have got lost. But thanks to people like Mr. Percival and so many others who have worked tirelessly, that we can get to see and appreciate this Christian art, you know, from the 17th century and 16th century till this date. Also, I must highlight here that this particular one does not look like a Goan or an Indian workmanship. It looks more Italian. It could be that it was brought by one of the missionaries to Goa when they were coming to Goa from Europe. In this case, but most of the Christian art that is found here was made by artists in Goa, most of it. But this is one rare example where we think that it was not, because it's also on marble, it's not ivory, it's marble in this case. Again, yeah, Good Shepherd. We have a similar piece in the Pilar Museum, but it's in wood, and Father Cosmi Costa calls it again the Krishna, you know. but here we have this Good Shepherd. There are a few representations like this around the world, and sometimes they are with the tree of life. In this case, there's no tree, just the grotto, and you can see Saint Mary Magdalene here, right at the bottom, yeah. And the fountain. Life, and the sheep and lamb rambling around, and Jesus sitting in a meditative posture and with a conch shell. So a lot of comparisons have been drawn with Krishna looking after his herd for in this case of the Good Shepherd. Hmm. Again, this is the pelican, a very Christian imagery of the pelican who's piercing her chest and feeding her babies her own flesh, and symbolizing sacrifice. And this particular object was made for the convent of Santa Monica in the 17th century. So it's silver on wood and about 1.5 meters high. Very interesting object, and a must see when you come to the museum next. But it does not look at all like a pelican. So from different angles, it looks, some say like a peacock and some say like an eagle, but nothing like a pelican. So it goes to show that the artist who was working on these objects might have been commissioned, might have had a sketch to look at, but had, you know, interpreted it in his own way,
cultural understanding. Context,
yeah. Yes. So in this case, it's a monstrance, which is meant for the... put the host on display, for veneration. And then you have the globe, which is a tabernacle. So this combination of a monstrance and tabernacle in the form of a pelican, it is very unique. I don't think it's seen anywhere else in the world. And that's what makes Goa's artistic heritage so unique, because the kind of objects that were crafted, were created here, many of them are similar to others. Like, you'll have many statues and images of the Virgin Mary and crucified Christ. But then you have some of these stunning ones, whether they are the paintings or murals inside the convent of Santa Monica, or, silver sculptures of these, like these that we are seeing right now, that are very unique to Goa. And it's something that we have to treasure and be proud of, and just keep alive for the future. I'll end this session with this reliquary chest of St. Francis Xavier. So this is a chest which is intricately carved. It's silver on wood again. And it, at one point, it had a piece of a vestment of St. Francis Xavier. So if you see here, it says, Sobre Pelis Don San Francisco. Let me just put this down, Don San Francisco. So it has here the trigram of Christ, which is also the logo of the Jesuits. So you have IHS, you have the cross, and you have three nails to the crucifixion of Christ. So again, the workmanship is very Indian. The silver or low relief work is seen on all sides, and the two sides, hopefully when you see it in the museum, you might be able to see the sides. It has the events connected to the life of St. Francis Xavier. So with this, I'll end, and maybe I will ask Fraser. Fraser, are you there? And if you can unmute. And, you know, since we are in the middle of the novenas of St. Francis Xavier, running up to the feast of St. Francis Xavier, we can have Fraser to join us and... you know,
that's a little,
this is a hymn to of St. Francis Xavier.
Yeah, sure. Am I audible, Natasha?
Yes, absolutely. You are.
Yeah.
I'll mute myself.
Thank you so much for giving me the chance to sing this hymn during this session. Okay, so this hymn was a composition by Pedro Salvador Carneiro from Bardez. And perhaps this hymn was sung for the first time at the exposition of St. Francis Xavier in 1931. Okay, so this is the hymn, rather an anthem given to the world by Mr. Peter from Bardez. Okay, so it goes like this. San Francisco Xaviera,
thank you. you so much, Fraser. That was so moving and
beautiful.
Thank you all for the comments. And yeah, well sung, Fraser. And it makes this session so much more meaningful. If any of you have questions for Heta or for me, we have a few minutes before we end the session. So you can either ask us directly or you can put it in the chat box, whichever you are more comfortable doing. Yeah, thank you so much, Nerissa, for joining this session. Chris, yes, a lot of churches were ruined and are gone and have disappeared, and so much art has gone. But what we have is what we need to make efforts to, you know, keep for the future. And that is what our efforts have to be focused on. Ruam, I'm not sure which artwork you are talking about.
My question simply was, it was any work of art brought from anywhere and put onto the church versus being created? I don't think I framed the question well.
No, what you need to ask me is if artworks were brought from elsewhere, like from Europe and placed in our churches in Goa, right? So initially, yes, that was, they must have done initially, must have brought works of art, you know, examples from there. And then, you know, I think here that there is a very, already a workshop here of talented artisans, artists who are capable of executing these works of art. They must have then reduce the number of works of art which they brought from there. But I think with reference to the Holy Trinity, that could be an example of something that could have been brought from Italy or from somewhere in Europe and placed in one of our churches or convents here in Goa.
Natasha and Ruam, one way of finding out whether an artwork or an icon or statue has been done by an Indian artist or by a European artist is to see the way the garments fall.
Yes.
See, we are used to seeing the dhoti and the sari and other Indian garments. So the Indian craftsmen rendered these garments, they rendered it with a flow, with a movement. But the Europeans were used to static garments. So when you see a statue with very static, straight lined garments, that's definitely been done in Europe by European artists. Mm.
Thanks, Ruam, for the question. Is there anyone else who would like to share their feedback or ask a question related to today's topic? You're most welcome. So Heta, there is so much more that needs to be seen and done. Of course, what we've done is just put into a capsule some of the works that we are more familiar with from here in Santa Monica and some things from around the place. But of course, in our churches, in every village, there is so much that you know, needs more research and more detailed study, photo documentation. There is a lot to be done and we've got to start somewhere. Fraser shared with me yesterday an image of the Virgin standing on a peacock. Fraser, correct me if I'm wrong.
Yeah, you're right.
Yeah, there is this image in the Holy Spirit. It's on one of the walls in the church. Fraser, if you can share some more details on that with us.
They say it depicts, you know, Parvati standing on a peacock. So like perhaps done by a Hindu artist from that locality at that point of time.
Mm-hmm.
It is located in the northern transept of the church, above the entrance, so above the door. So that is one unique feature. Also, and another very unique thing about Holy Spirit Church is it has the announcement of the wedding of Mary with Joseph, Saint Joseph.
So that is a painting, or it is?
No, it's a statue.
Okay.
You know, a combination of three statues.
Okay.
And an altar. So that is not seen anywhere else, as far I know. So okay. I have never seen come across. So that's something unique to our church as well.
Okay. So yeah, there are a couple of questions, Heta. One from Akshay asking, what were the biggest influences in Goa? I mean, you're asking it in reference to the European Renaissance. There has been reference to the paintings that I've shown you of the Santa Monica to Flemish, you know, works of art, or references that were used to do these paintings were based on Flemish works. So that I know for sure. That so the Flemish works must have been from the 14th and 15th century, and then used as references for these artworks here in the Santa Monica. And if there is any other fresco art in Goa's churches, I'm sure there is. Like the one in the Holy Spirit, there must be many other cases of fresco art in Goa's churches as well. But like I said, there are 161 parish churches, and correct me if I'm wrong, but I think there are 161 parish churches in Goa. And then there are so many chapels. I think there's a chapel in Bodda that was recently done, recently meaning maybe 10, 15 years back, by Jose Pereira. I don't know whether Fraser or any of y'all on that side have seen that work of art. That is more recent though. But there is fresco art
at Bodda.
Yes.
Chapel. Yeah.
Okay. There are many books, but maybe not all of them. There are many, but not everything contained in one book, Ruam. So you know, the museum has a catalog of the museum's collection, but. The other information is just spread out over many books, which you can, Central Library is a good place to find references and read about it.
Also Xavier Center.
Also Xavier Center has many books, and Aarti, I don't know if Aarti is at Xavier Center still, but Aarti is a good Aarti's person there. to help you, you know, find these books and help you read a little more about this. Most of it sometimes is in Portuguese, and some of us find it difficult to read, but hopefully we'll have more researchers writing in English so that all of us here in India can take advantage of it. And Marissa, from where, fresco art in Goa's churches, is that what you're referring to? I'm not sure. In what context? The Fraser's picture, the one of the Virgin on a peacock, is from the Holy Spirit Church.
Margao,
yes. Okay, great. So if there are no more questions, we will end today's session with a thanks to Heta. Thank you so much for joining and, you know, being part of this journey in exploring and understanding these works a little better. And to all of you who joined our sessions, there is a question from Daniel Heta. It says, "Hi ma'am, many households in Goa own very detailed and old artwork in the form of wooden engravings, oratorios, statues, murals. Given that most people aren't aware of the skilled artisans who can help preserve this pieces of art, how can we stay informed and be made aware of such experts in the field, and any if you recommend?" Okay, so I think this is something that maybe I can help you answer, Daniel, is, you know, the care of our collections in our homes. Basically, we can all do preventive conservation and not really conserve them ourselves, but we can clean them if there's dust settled on them. But if there's an arm of an image which is broken, there aren't many trained conservators that we have with us. But Fraser, you know, he's one of them who's very passionate and tries to find solutions. But he's also done a short stint of an internship here with us when INTAC, that's the Indian National Trust for Art and Cultural Heritage, they were here with us for a year. And he joined them and saw how they used to conserve objects. So he saw firsthand how conservation is taken up. So what we would advise anyone who has old objects in their house and needs to be conserved, here in Goa, I would suggest you consult the Biko family, that is Nixon and Glenn and their father Agnello, who have a lot of experience, have been conserving church art objects. So yes, that would be the first point of contact. And yes, other than that, I would recommend Intact, but there are many other private conservators in and around India. Here in Goa, I'm not too sure, but I would recommend the Biko family to consult with, and if they can help you, they will definitely do that. And there's always Fraser who will give you very sound advice, besides me, who will advise, can give you advice and help you find the best conservator for your particular objects to be conserved.
Yes, definitely.
Okay. So once again, thanks, Heta. Thank you all for joining our session. And we'll keep you informed of our next session, which, as I mentioned, will be with José Pestana. He's a Portuguese art conservator and has worked with us at the Church of Santa Monica. And even in the Museum of Christian Art, he's just conserved in the arch in the museum last year. So it will be great talking to him and understanding how he went about conserving these murals in the Church of Santa Monica. So that's coming up in a couple of weeks. We'll keep you all informed through our social media pages. We will also be launching the Museum of Christian Art website on the 1st of December, hoping all goes well. Oh, and so it is a new website with a lot of information about the collection, about the museum. And, you know, I hope you all will all log in and check out the website when it is launched. And looking forward to our following sessions and looking forward to seeing you all at the museum when we reopen next year. Thanks once again. Thank you. Thanks, Heta.
Thank you, Natasha.
Thanks, Fraser, for the lovely rendition of San Francisco Xaviera. It means so much.
Thank you so much.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Thanks, everybody.
Bye-bye.
Bye.